This video contains a practical example of OSINT. Everything shown here is for educational purposes only. OSINT stands for Open Source Intelligence. The goal is using a person's name and maybe some basic information to learn as much as possible about them. What you use to achieve your goal is anything you can get from open databases that are available on the internet. Leaked information such as hacked databases is not OSINT, and using it can get you in trouble. OSINT is a big field and I can't cover every way of getting information, but I will show you how to do it properly. The important things to learn from this video are the methods and trail of thought of gathering intelligence. OSINT is widely used nowadays. The police will use it on you if you are a person of interest. They don't need a warrant for that. Employers will use OSINT if you go to an interview, but it will be to a lesser extent. I recommend to use it on yourself to know how much others can learn about you from using open data sources on the internet. Using OSINT is not against the law. How you choose to use the information you discovered is a different question. What do you need to know in order to do open source intelligence? It doesn't require any programming skills or technical knowledge. There are tools meant to help with OSINT, but they search information in networks that nobody uses, which is why I don't find them necessary. I just open a new text file. I focus on the platforms that the majority of people use. I write interesting information that I find and decide what to use later. The person I will use as a case study for my investigation is someone who screwed me out of a lot of money. For obvious reasons, I will censor private information since publishing it is considered doxing. Before you start, you should know that big websites use heatmaps and keylogger tools to monitor and record your activity. When using OSINT on social media, I recommend creating new accounts rather than using your personal ones. For LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram, the platforms I will focus on for my investigation, I have to use an account in order to get data. The first thing I do is writing the name of my subject in Google. The top result is of an artist who shares the same name as my subject. That's a good example because when doing OSINT, you must focus on what's relevant or you will be wasting a lot of time. In this specific case, I know that a Wikipedia page is not going to give me the information I need. You could keep digging when you use Google. You could search for your subject's name, combined with their place of residence, for example. But I move on to search for information on social media. My next stop is a website called LinkedIn. One of this website's features is that a subject is notified whenever someone checks their profile. This is quite normal on LinkedIn though, but you should be careful not to make your subject alarmed or they might delete some of what they shared online. One way of staying under the radar is the option of browsing profiles anonymously. I searched for my subject and there are multiple profiles with this name, so I know which one to choose by the photo. In the profile itself, I can see the entire work history of this person. There is a lot of irrelevant information here, and you decide what to filter out. In this case, I'm interested mostly in the current workplace and location. Since I find this important, I will copy it to my text file. I also go back to the beginning of his career and look at his education. Since there is a good chance that he studied close to his hometown, I might be able to find where his family lives from what I learn here. The activity tab will display his actions on LinkedIn. I could find people he is in contact with, but I feel like this information won't give me a lot of insight, so I will continue to my next source of information. With my new Facebook profile, I will see what I can learn about my target from this platform. Looking at the profile page alone, I see that my subject is cautious about his data. The only updates I can see on his timeline as a user who is not on his friends list are his latest cover photo update and some posts about music and entertainment preferences from many years ago. I can also see his hometown and current residence. Because I checked my subject's LinkedIn profile, I know that the information about his current location is not updated on Facebook. According to his work history from LinkedIn, this piece of information was true more than a year ago. If I continue digging in his profile, I see that he doesn't share anything publicly, which I would recommend to anyone watching this video. The only photo I have access to is the current cover photo. As of the time I posted this video, a cover photo, along with anyone who liked it, can only be public. That's why I look at the list of users who liked the photo to find close contacts to my subject. On this list, I find a girl who I know was in relationship with him, and two people who share his family name. It's time to expand my investigation to contacts of my target, starting with the girl who was my subject's partner. Her Facebook page is completely private. I don't want to waste time on it, so I will move on to check her current residence according to LinkedIn. On LinkedIn, I see that she lives in the same city as my target. Her profile states that she has been there for less time. It is possible that she moved later, or that she was there for the same amount of time, and didn't want to write that she is not employed. This is quite common on LinkedIn. Saying that you were not working might hurt your chances of getting a job in the industry. Regardless, I believe that the fact that she lives in the same location as my subject suggests that they are still in relationship. Therefore, I decide to look her name up on Google and see what I find. I don't see new insights in Google, so I'll consider it a dead end and move on. Next, I want to see what I can find on the two people who share my subject's last name. The first person is an elder woman who lives in a different country. My guess is that this is my subject's aunt. The second person is also an elder woman. She doesn't share any information publicly, except for her current residence, and her residence is not far from my subject's hometown. She could be either an aunt or his mom. She hides her friends list, but I see another person with my subject's family name who liked her cover photo. This person looks old enough to be my subject's grandfather, and his friends list is public. I search for the last name in the list and get a few more family members. If I wanted to find more about my subject's family, I could search for his last name combined with his hometown on Facebook. This gives me some candidates who could be part of his family. It depends on how much you want to learn on your target's relatives. Every contact person you find is like a branch that leads to new information, and you need to decide when digging is beneficial and when it is a waste of time. From my experience, it is best to focus on your subject, their partner, and their close family and friends, because outside circles won't reveal much relevant discoveries. Women tend to share more personal information over the internet. I did OSINT in the past on other subjects and managed to get their home address by googling their partner's name. You won't always be that lucky, but you could try to take advantage of this statistic. I will stop with my subject's family members, since I think you get the idea. Going back to my subject, let's see what I can find on Instagram. My subject either have a non-active account or he doesn't use Instagram. Let's see if I can find his partner's account. Once again, I'm not getting anywhere here. His partner's full name doesn't give me anything, and deleting her middle name yields too many results. I won't dig into that, but I can give a general tip. If you can find photos of your subject on social media, you could sometimes conclude what is their place of residence. I once had two possible addresses of a subject, and I used his wife's Instagram to compare one of her photos to see if it looks like one of the addresses used in Google Street View. You could also check public records for address or phone number registrations. As for me, I will stop here and summarize my investigation. I started with basic information. Now I have my subject's current location and workplace. I know who is his partner and what she does for a living. I know who are some of his family members. All I found came from Google and some social media platforms. I didn't have any contact with my subject or his contact people to ask for more information. Doing so enters a new field called social engineering, and I decided not to cover it in this video. What you learned here is a powerful technique, so I hope that if you choose to use it, you will do it to someone who deserves it. And the final lesson I want you to learn is that you should be careful with what information you post about yourself, because you never know what some psycho on the internet is going to find about you.